This session is entitled Unleashing the Power of LTE, and we're going to be discussing the impact that LTE is having on the mobile industry and the wider ecosystem. We're going to be covering a wide range of areas, including technology, services, and devices. And I'm delighted to be joined by a great lineup of industry experts. There will be an opportunity later for our audience to ask questions, and I'm sure our panel will be delighted to address anything you may have to ask. First off, let me introduce the panel. To my immediate left is Rajiv Singh Malares, the president of Alcatel-Lucent's Asia Pacific division. Rajiv, welcome.
Thank you.
To Rajiv's left is Dr. Sanchi Li, CTO of the Carrier Network Business Group for Chinese vendor Huawei. Welcome. And we also have Alex Jinsung Choi, who is the Executive Vice President and Head of ICT and R&D at South Korean operator SKT. Welcome, Alex.
Hello.
Let's kick off, if we can. I'm going to set the scene a little bit. If we look at the LTE industry today, globally, we've got over 100 million connections. It's the fastest growing radio access technology I think the mobile industry has ever seen. And still, LTE makes up about 2% of the global connections base. So that gives us some idea that there is huge potential for growth out there. And the industry is expected to grow from 160 networks today to over 400 live LTE networks by December 2017. And if we look at Asia, Asia is really helping to drive this growth. Some recent forecasts from GSMA Intelligence predict that LTE connections in Asia will grow tenfold between 2013 and 2017 to reach 500 million. By 2017, half of the world's LTE connections are expected to come from Asia. But while we have this great growth, we're also seeing some societal trends impacting our industry. We're seeing rapid global urbanization. The United Nations forecasts that 70% of the world's people will live in cities by 2050, and 10 of the top 21 megacities will be here in Asia. And we're seeing increasing demand for smartphones and tablets. This is placing huge pressure on our networks. We've all seen the statistics that smartphones generate as much data traffic as 20 mobile phones, and a tablet generates over 100 times as much traffic. So our networks, as we understand, are really under great pressure at the moment. We hear a lot of talk about the mobile economy, and it's proven that mobile broadband is economically disruptive. According to joint research from the World Economic Forum and Bell Labs, mobile broadband with the right applications brings 36% more GDP growth than just broadband alone. That's quite a statistic. So with that scene hopefully set a little, I'm going to open up the discussion by reviewing the kind of services and applications that are driving this mobile economy. Let's have a look at how mobile broadband is really transforming lives. And I'm going to start with Rajiv. Rajiv, what impact do you see LTE having on everyday life? Can you give us any examples? We hear lots of talk about this mobile economy, but how is LTE really changing and doing something that perhaps 3G didn't do beforehand?
Right. Well, it's a very, very good question, and I feel a little self-conscious being on the stage with Alex from SKT, because, of course, Korea is the country that is leading the world in terms of adoption of LTE, and I think by the end of the year, 60% plus of all subscribers in that country will be on LTE devices. So I think, Alex, I will let you talk about the U-Cities initiative, which I think is one of the more interesting ones that the Korean government has launched with a number of universities to do the kinds of things that we all talk about, the quotidian things like getting a bus and knowing when the bus comes and getting alerts on your phone, to being able to park in advance because you know where the spots are. Those kinds of applications are the simple, easy ones, and I think in many ways Korea, it's being rolled out. It hasn't been rolled out yet, is a good example. One of the things we've done in the United States, in Charlotte, North Carolina, for instance, is with first response units for fire and police are hooked up to an LTE network now. And it allows real-time video feeds, and you can, I mean, I think we've all talked about the theory of this. The faster you get to a fire, the more lives you save, the faster the police can get to a conflict point, the better it is. So that's happening now, and the benefits will become real. I guess the point about education, the point about urban living is that it's still too early. Mm-hmm. We did this study that showed broadband connections, broadly defined, accelerate GDP growth, but the use of LTE specifically is still in the infant stages. And as I said, we start to see some things in the US and again in Korea that are a taste of things to come, but early days.
Okay. Alex, can you give us some case studies perhaps? As Rajiv said, you are an LTE pioneer in this era.
Yeah, I strongly agree with what Rajiv just mentioned. And SK Telecom, we are very proud of being one of the front runner in terms of LTE service pioneers. In terms of penetration rate, probably our company has the highest penetration rate, LTE penetration rate. And when it comes to the LTE service applications, in a nutshell, I think video service is actually driving these LTE services. Of course, there are many other new services which were introduced after our LTE commercial launch about 2 years ago. For example, we are very lucky to have this IPTV services even before the LTE service. And then it decided to transform this mobile IPTV services to the LTE wireless network. And it was quite successful. And people actually really love the mobile IPTV services nowadays. One probably reason why the mobile IPTV service is so successful in Korean market is because most Asian countries, they are very dense. The population is very consolidated, like a metropolitan area. It's highly packed, and also that because of that, the public transportation is very much well developed, like a subway, public bus. So many customers, they spend quite a long time on the subway and this bus during the commuting. So that's probably the right target for the... So this might not be the case in any other countries outside the Asian countries. So this is a unique situation, and that... So I think that's one reason. But we hope that we will see more innovative, more LTE-fitted adequate applications going forward, and we are making quite an effort, making that happen.
Sanchi, is IPTV an area that your customers, the carriers and operators, are looking at you for help and guidance?
Oh, yes. I'd like to talk a little bit more about this LTE. So this time is different from the past. Past is more from 2G, 1G, 2G, 3G. It's more technology driven, but this is really, this time is business transformation when we move to LTE. So we have engaged substantially with our carriers, and many of them have different requirements like smart city and others, education and so on, a multimedia. But they are still in the early stage of engagement to great extent because the business model, how do you make money? How do you, build this infrastructure to compete or collaborate with the OTT, the digital economy ecosystem? So this is what we have seen, and substantially we have engaged. But I want to point out one of the special cases, it's what we have seen is just more on the consumer side, but it's moving towards the enterprise world and to the industry world, right? As you mentioned earlier, example 36% of GDP. So the enterprise LTE, I'd like to talk a little bit more on that part. We have a lot of engagement, and we have an early trial and even deployment. And take an example. I just give you an example. like we call ELTE, Enterprise LTE. We have like project or deployment in like e-government in Tianjin City. Okay, we have a seaport in Yantai City. We have airport project for the ELTE, mainly the broadband trunking, not just the voice, but also data, video surveillance, multimedia. Okay, and we have power grid activities related to LTE in Zhuhai City, and also oil field deployment in Norway. And many of these things, which covers a lot of vertical segment, you can see, right? It's what used to be like broadband trunking, right? It's become LTE broadband trunking. So we do see a lot of such engagement, which likely to generate right business models when you move to the enterprise or industry sectors. You know, plus all this activity enabled by the cloud, by the analytics. So we have an early a trial and deployment in that area. I think it's a complement to, you know, consumer end, where we also see clearly in, you know, the video, you know, EMBS, you know, activities there.
So we've talked about some of the services that the LTE is enabling. Let's have a look and discuss the technical challenges. Also that are facing the LTE industry at the moment. I mentioned at the beginning that the fact we are seeing global urbanization. You know, cities mean density. Density is always going to be a challenge for both coverage and capacity for operators. If we talk about what the industry can do to tackle this growing problem of providing quality coverage when our cities are just becoming more and more overcrowded, what can we do? I mean, Rajiv, as a vendor, this has got to be top of your list, isn't it, for what operators are coming to you and say, we need help with this?
Absolutely, and Alex said it. I mean, Asia in particular has probably more of the biggest cities in the world and the densest urban populations in the world than any other, arguably, I think, maybe Latin America. But so this is a good microcosm for small cells. And I note 3 years ago, I remember, not here in Shanghai, but in another GSMA event, having a debate with someone from another company about the future of macro cells versus small cells. And at the time, it was a real debate. I don't think it's a real debate anymore. I think everyone now accepts that the future is going to be about these hetnets and that small cells will solve a fundamental coverage and capacity issue in those dense urban environments, not simply because there are a lot of people per square kilometer, but because of what they do. And I mean, you've seen the projections of data growth, which is, we've estimated 40 to 80x growth of data traffic, and it's mostly video. One of the carriers I was speaking to this morning was telling me 60, 70% of their data traffic is all video, and it puts an extraordinary strain on the network. But that's the network. The end user doesn't care about the network. They care about what they're experiencing. And one of the ways to ensure good quality experience on a consistent basis, wherever you happen to be in Seoul or in Tokyo or in Tianjin, is through small cells. So we are, in fact, all of you who happen to be China Mobile customers here will experience, if you turn on your phone, TD-LTE in this hall, in Hall 1. I don't think this is Hall 1, but Hall 1 has, we wired it up with China Mobile using small cells that we jointly developed with them. So this is the future, and it's coming. And it's coming very quickly in Korea in particular, which is, again, leading the way.
Yeah, Alex, I know you, SK, have a big headnet strategy. Is small cells part of that?
Yeah, of course, yeah. Small cell, headnet is the way to go going forward. But then when you start to deploy the small cells, you immediately run into some other problems like backhaul issues, mm-hmm. and also all this increased interference issues. Because if you go for the small cells, that naturally, you know, increase your handover area. So if you are not managing this increased interferences between the small cells, you may lose some capacity and performance. So you have to be very clever to make your networks much more service aware and interference aware. So you should put some interference coordination mechanism somewhere in your network so that the, you know, it doesn't cause any serious performance degradation issues. And also, to achieve that goal, probably we strongly believe in the self-organizing network. So that without this artificial intelligence-based or analytics-based self-organizing network, it's going to be almost impossible to coordinate all these real-time interference issues.
I'd like to ask you, Alex, as well. For the last couple of years, Wi-Fi has been seen as a solution to help operators with their capacity and coverage problems. You know, many operators use it as an offloading technique. With the emergence of technologies such as small cells, what do you think is the future for carrier Wi-Fi 1 or 2 years down the line? Will it be replaced by some of the small cell technology we're seeing, or will operators globally still continue to use Wi-Fi?
Yeah, we always consider Wi-Fi as our complementary net connectivities because Wi-Fi is much more cost efficient, and also, you know, so we see there's a huge potential of the Wi-Fi going forward in the future. And then, I mean, it's a perfect data offloading connectivities, but as you said, when we started to deploy the small cells, then, you know, there are some duplications. But I think still we believe Wi-Fi can play a quite an important role. Before to achieve that, we have to resolve some handover issues between mobile cellular network and Wi-Fi networks. So I think Wi-Fi Alliance is doing a good job, launching some hotspot 2.0, something like that. So I think that with that features probably will provide more higher quality of user experience.
Sanchi, from Huawei's perspective, I know you talk a lot about software-defined networking, SDN, and you see this as a real kind of game changer for the LTE industry.
Yeah, I think we talk about the wire go about business enabling, open up the networks to create more solid business cases, right? And also, this is also very much related to the network optimization, okay, as a total end-to-end solution in the network infrastructure. This is what we, overall our strategy, we call SoftCom, which is basically you are familiar with the big data analytics, the cloud, the software-defined networks, and network virtualization, functional virtualization, all these together. But if look at this, how do we optimize? Because the cost, our customer really consider, now how do I migrate the network? What kind of infrastructure I should build? So let's start from the spectrum optimization perspective. So what we have a build architecture, you know, we have a, what we call SRC, it's a single radio controller, which covers the 2G, 3G, and 4G, and help the migration to do the HetNet resource dynamics across different cell sizes, right? And also, and this SRC, and the next is we call cloud broadband, cloud BB. It's like a clustering of the BBU, and so you can optimize the resources of multi-cells and multi-band, multi-mode. You know, all these things happening, build this on top of that. I can give you three examples quickly. Okay, one example, we have the refarming from the GSM to LTE 1800. And this is a big success in EE in UK. As you possibly know, they build, you know, they cover now in UK about 70% of population, okay, with this refarming. And the take-up rate is 25%. The subscriber take up the upgrade to LTE. And they sign up more than 1,000 enterprise account, okay, and with these solutions, and to help them migrate. Help. And the other things is more like intelligences. Where the intelligence at the spectrum level across cells. The other example, like we have this LTECA, right? The carrier aggregation, the multi-band issues, right? So we have a lot of engagement there and early deployment. like such as cell interconnections through the CA, and such as recently, and also with the HetNet CA, we have implement with Vodafone. Okay, and also in Russia, we have like TDD plus FDD combined and 2CC deployment and this trials and also related to CA part. So this is LTE, how do you optimize resources through these two key components as an infrastructure. Okay, the last one I like to mention, recently we did optimization shows what we call no edge for the LTE. By no edge, you know the cells, when you move to the edge, the bandwidth is reduced by 10 times, right? So we optimize multi-cell with different technology based on the customer behavior. We can improve the edge bandwidth by 500%. So it's virtually, so important, you talk about user experiences. How can you guarantee the user experience when we move to cells, different size, different locations? So these are important to build intelligence, like what Alex just talked about it, to truly optimize at the spectrum level. Then you move up, it's the EPC side. Right? How do you build what we call single EPCs, more like cloud EPC solution? Okay, and to push the EPC more towards edge to improve the quality of the experiences. And furthermore, on top of that, we have all the activities, like you can call it more related to NFV, network function virtualization, like what we call GILAN, and also video delivery. How do you do the caching? And GILAN related to all this traffic coming into the EPC, how do you do the traffic steering, the DPI, the firewall, and so on. So how do we form this total solution? That's what we call OR strategy. We call the South Mobile. Mm-hmm. Okay, for South Mobile specific. Overall, our company as a carrier network business group, we call it Southcom. But specifically for the mobile, is the South Mobile strategy.
Rajiv, this Alcatel-Lucent put such a great focus on, Huawei talks a lot about this software strategy, I think, defining the future of networks. Is Alcatel-Lucent in agreement with that?
Absolutely, it's coming. I mean, you've just been given an exposition on the technical aspects of it, so I'm not going to talk about our specific strategy. But what I am going to say is that carriers like SKT, like AT&T, like Verizon, like Orange, and probably even more so here in Asia, given the low ARPUs, are under extraordinary pressure to optimize their spend at the network level, and this clearly is going to be one of the potential breakthroughs when it gets fully implemented. But it's going to take some time. Mm. It's going to absolutely take some time. So notwithstanding the tests and the proof of concepts that we're all doing, I don't see this becoming really scale for another 3 or 4 years.
Okay. So we've talked about technology. We've talked about some of the services behind LTE. Let's talk about what is often called the oxygen of our industry, an overused phrase and an old one. But of course, none of what we're talking about today is possible without spectrum. Use of spectrum for LTE in Asia is actually quite different to other parts of the world, really. At present, none of the launches for LTE in Asia Pacific are based on the 700 megahertz band, as an example. And most LTE launches in Asia have actually been in the above 1 gigahertz frequency. We have, however, seen some developments in the last week, and we've seen efforts by regulators in Asia to try and harmonize LTE spectrum around the 700 megahertz digital dividend band. Last week, we saw 4 countries, Brunei, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Singapore, all who plan to allocate the digital dividend spectrum band to mobile. Rajiv, if I can come to you on this question, I mean, how important, bearing in mind the success of LTE around the world, how important is harmonization, particularly around this 700 megahertz digital dividend band, to the healthy growth of LTE in Asia? Is this critical?
The way you phrased it is hard to answer that question. Is it critical? I mean, look, will it help? Absolutely. The harmonization of the APT 700 plan, if it happens, and it happens quickly, I think it could have tremendous benefit. There's no doubt about it. And just for the audience, I mean, the benefits are, I think, somewhat self-explanatory in the sense that if you have one common approach to spectrum at the 700 band level, then you get, you know, roaming agreements that are easy and to put in place, so there's not a lot of time and effort associated with that. And more interestingly, the device manufacturers all start to create more devices more quickly because they see the scale of subscribers. And some people have said the potential, if it gets adopted globally, APT 700 could be as much as 3 billion users, although I think that's probably a little large. And then, of course, for people like us that make equipment that power the networks, our roadmaps would all start to accelerate to deploy it. So the potential is there, but you could ask the question, but if the potential is there, why aren't we moving quickly? Well, of course, switching off analog television impacts potentially a lot of people who don't have a digital set. So governments are quick to commit, but maybe a little bit slower to actually make it happen. So I think it's the good news from what I see in carriers is that everybody's planning. Everybody has it in their in how they're thinking about their own value propositions. So it's coming, but of course there are other issues. You know, the U.S. has its own plan. TD-LTE is going to also throw a little bit of a spanner in there, and of course the Europeans are unfortunately lagging a little bit in clarity on this one. So those three things alone could slow even more the progress we're making. But we are making, so I don't mean to be a pessimist. The progress is actually quite strong, and Asia in many ways is, I think, not once again, because I think Europe led the last revolution, but Asia could actually lead this next revolution.
Alex, as an operator, obviously you haven't deployed in the digital dividend band, do all operators continue to face spectrum challenges? I mean, as we said earlier, you've been very successful with LTE. You've got more than 10 million subscribers. I think you've got, somebody said you've got more, it's growing at a faster rate than your 3G subscribers. But, you know, are you kind of hampered by spectrum, or is that not an issue in Korea for you?
I mean, spectrum is always an issue, and spectrum harmonization, especially the LTE smart spectrum harmonization, is absolutely necessary, considering the fact that the existing LTE spectrum is too much fragmented. So it's no good for the operator, no good for the device manufacturers. So it's critically important. And you know, in Korea, you know, so Korean regulators is working on, you know, providing more spectrum for LTE services. So we are very fortunate.
Yeah. Okay. Let's talk about devices as well from a consumer's end point of view. You know, if we can't get the handsets or the smartphones or the tablets out to the user, then the LTE industry, you know, can't maximize its potential. Rajiv, I think you're quite a strong supporter of getting cheaper smartphones out into the industry, and there are a number of initiatives out there.
Right.
But are we at a stage where we're still being, you know, we're not able to do as much as we can because of the device market? In the mobile industry, it always seems as though we build the networks, we get the services, and then we go, oh no, we haven't got the devices yet.
Right.
You know, are we still there, or have we learned from previous?
Well, it's a 3G experience, isn't it, ultimately? I mean, so you cited at the beginning this Bell Lab study we did on the accelerator effect, if you will, on GDP growth of getting more applications on the broadband infrastructure. And the key to unlock that is not just the apps, but for increasing lower socioeconomic bands, it's the device. And 3 years ago, at another conference, I said $50, 300 RMB is the sweet spot. And people looked at me and said, that's never going to happen. I think we're now, if you read the newspapers in the last 3 months, you're starting to see a lot of people talk about a $50, $60 handset becoming a real viability. And the fact is you can all go to one of the markets just down the road and buy a $50 smartphone, but try and use it and your viewers, the experience won't be so great. So the issue is a $50, 300 RMB handset that is of reasonably high quality that a sophisticated customer, like many of the customers here in China, will want to buy versus a brand name phone. It's coming. I mean, Samsung said a $100 smartphone is coming. I know some of the manufacturers privately were telling me that they're targeting $60 smartphone devices. The Mozilla OS, which is one of the drivers of cost, this is saying that they have a lightweight OS that will power a cheaper cheaper device, and then you don't need that expensive middleware. And once that happens, you know, watch out. The networks are going to just continue. Now, the only thing I'll continue growing in terms of data traffic, the only thing I think that fundamentally needs a rethink then is the business model for the carrier. The traditional prepaid, postpaid model won't work anymore. And so I think two things will have to happen. One is tiered pricing. And again, I remind the audience, 3 years ago, as an industry, we were all scared. I would use an even stronger expression, scared about, you know, the internet is free, our kids are all getting used to free. Will we ever be able to discipline them and charge them for, and guess what, we've disciplined them and everybody's now used to essentially having to pay if you use more. So tiered pricing is just going to continue to accelerate. And then the other one is advertising as a subsidy. Fact of the matter is today in most places we don't put up with advertising, but you know, to go lower and lower in the socioeconomic bands, I think advertising is going to become a part of the acceptable value proposition for carriers, whether we like it or not. Mm-hmm.
Sanjay, do you agree that the business model for devices will change as well? I know that you're on the network side of things, but obviously Huawei has a huge vested interest
yes.
devices.
I like to follow both of them, the complexity of, and also the spectrum fragmentation become a major issue. Mm-hmm. Right, today you almost have like, in the LTE side, you know, as a global player, we see like roughly 15 to 20 bands. Okay, and that has impact on the handset side, on the client side, mm-hmm. devices side. So Huawei actually invested substantially, not on the network side, but also on handset. How do you support multi-band, multi-mode technology? And software now, fortunately, on the LTE all converge, no matter it's TDD or FDD, right? And but the handset side, we got to have the technology drive the price down. From vendor perspective, provide the handset solution. Now, I completely agree. Today, you see the LTE early adoption is more on the high-end market. Today, largely carrier, now even though people talk about not take the same 3G business model as a heavy, you know, subscriber subsidy model, but it turns out it's still the same, right? But as market getting bigger and penetrate to the low-end market, okay, and this has to be find the right business model, not only cut the hardware cost or have an open source like Mozilla's model, mm-hmm. but also having the right business model. Now, this is very important. For we have engaged with many carrier. You know, carrier also has been hurt by that, mm-hmm. handset subsidies, right? Mm-hmm. So, and this is, we have been engaged with them, you know, how do we help together to build the solutions.
Thank you. I wanted to move on and touch on a subject that when I was putting some notes together around the discussion points for what we were going to talk about, I've noted that this is an area that has a lot of hype, and it's LTE advanced. Now, as it happens, the hype, I think today, turned into reality with SK Telecom launching LTE advanced technology in parts of South Korea. Alex, tell us a little bit about your vision for LTE advanced, because as I said, this is something that has been hyped. Mm-hmm. You know, there's no kind of standard set technical definition for what actually comprises LTE advanced. There's a lot of technology behind it. Tell us about your vision for South Korea.
Yeah, first of all, we are very proud of making our company's announcement of world first LTE advanced services, the commercial services being deployed in Korean market. And the key feature of LTE advanced is the carrier aggregation. So meaning that you actually can use, you know, multiple channels simultaneously. That way you can double your bandwidth, peak data rate from 75 all the way up to 150 megabps per user. That's the key point of LTE advanced carrier aggregation. Of course, there are many more features going forward, like TM9 or EICIC, and there is additional LTE advanced features surely provide more throughputs in the near future. And our company's vision is, of course, to provide the mobile services with the higher data rate than the fixed line services. So I think today, I think we made a very important milestone that way. And so once again, once we have this ultra high bandwidth mobile services, probably combined with this new mobile devices, smart devices with a larger display, higher resolution, and much powerful CPU and longer battery life, and more connectivities, and then combine this together, the customers' capability of moving around while doing their jobs better than before, like a mobile office or mobile entertainment. That dream will become true.
Rajiv, what kind of momentum? I mean, South Korea is SK Telecom in South Korea is the first operator in the world to actually commercially launch LTE Advanced. What kind of momentum are you seeing as a vendor behind LTE Advanced? Is this going to be a fast rollout, or is this something in most parts of the world still 2 or 3 years away, do you think?
Well, we're crowning Korea. Clearly, Korea is the lead, so I'm congratulations, but not surprised that you're the first to roll it out. On a big scale, we're all doing tests, both in the lab and with customers, and I think that you and I were talking about the U.S., the carriers in the U.S. have announced that they're committed to it and that they will be deploying it, and I think it's just a matter, if the trends continue in accelerating a subscriber uptake in the U.S., it's not quite as fast as Korea, but it is accelerating quite quickly, and I think it's going to accelerate now that the number three player is also recommitting to more LTE deployment that the U.S. carriers start to deploy. And, this really is about optimizing the performance of the cells and therefore the performance of the end user. So it's coming, it's backward compatible for the infrastructure that's in place. So we're committed, and I know everybody's committed in the industry. And I think it's probably going to move faster than people think over the next 3 years.
You're nodding.
If you look at LTE advanced, and it's kind of delayed by standard, right? We expect possibly by end of the year, before it's mid of the year, to finalize the version. But from technical perspective, we are ready. Okay, it's not finalized, but we as Huawei, as the number one contributor in LTE standard activities and contributions, and we are ready from chip to software. We're just now wait to finalize the version, because carrier always want to have the standard open capabilities. So we would expect by time the standard become ready, it takes about 6 to 9 months for the solutions to be ready and for carrier to deploy. So I'm more possibly optimistic from technical perspective, but like what Rajiv also mentioned, it's really depend on the certain market. We have customers are pushing us as quickly as possible. And we just have to wait for the standard to be ready. And we are fully committed, yes.
Finally, from my point of view, it would be remiss, I think, for us to be here in Shanghai and not talk about the LTE market opportunity in China. The world's biggest mobile market is yet to deploy LTE. Sanjeev, just give us some idea of the kind of market opportunity that China is it's a strange situation where we have the world's biggest market and yet to roll out LTE. Have you got any Can you give us any inside information as to when we're going to see LTE
well,
in China?
Put this way, today we have LTE, we are serving about 10 million LTE subscribers. We have about 180 plus contracts, commercial contracts in place, and worldwide, you know, EPC plus the LTE together. And this year we expect our revenue on the LTE side to double. Okay, and not the handset side, okay, just the network part. And also we expect to sign about 100 new contract, commercial contract for the deployment. And now talk about the China. China Mobile just had a talk there, so people possibly are aware of that. By end of the year, 200,000 e-notes, right? By end of next year, 350,000. And overall, if you look at China Mobile, GSM Solutions has about 600,000 to cover the whole nation. So you can see the speed, okay, the incredible, right, the market. So we are, if you look at the delivery schedule, we are ahead of the schedule. Okay, we're confident and closely working with the China Mobile, obviously. So. And I think it's the handset part, it's more important, you know, how these things can take off. Mm-hmm. And also the business side, you know, business side, how the things can really, you know, move up. This is like, it's huge market, everyone see it. And, but I think it's from the business perspective, how do you make a network truly open, you know, enabling? How do you create the ecosystems? We have a lot of initiations with the China carrier in that aspect. But what are the business model for them to, for the carrier to fully step on it? Okay, to that's a still like, it will take some time. Mm-hmm. You know, relate to the billing, how to make money, how to do the advertising for carrier, right? So all these things are still evolving.
Rajiv, this must be a huge potential.
It's beyond the technical part, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So, I mean, I spend most of my time worrying and thinking and pushing and with my very bad Mandarin, trying to converse with decision makers, but it's coming. I mean, so I think that it's the accelerator is being pushed. The trials have been done, and now we're into the commercial part with China Mobile, all of us. And they have set a very ambitious target that by the end of this year, this first tranche of build of 200,000 base stations will be rolled out in 100 plus cities here in China, and potentially a much larger number than that. So the other two carriers, and you've seen it here at the event, are talking now about LTE as well, and they're moving. The issue is, of course, when does MIIT issue the licenses, and assurances are coming that it's coming this year. So, and once it happens, is, you know, watch out, the floodgates are open. It's going to be an interesting ride here in China because, of course, the stress on the network, again, is going to be, I mean, it's China scale, right? I mean, what else do I need to say?
Gentlemen, unfortunately, that is all the time we have time for today. I would like to thank you for taking part and hope we've given our audience some insight into the LTE market. We have covered a lot of ground. And hopefully we've given everybody something to think about. That does also wrap up our conference program for today at Mobile Asia Expo. So I'm going to wish everybody a good evening, and we will see you back here tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you.